in the inaugural Wooden Classic. From the pond in Anaheim, California, NBC presents a sports special, the John R. Wooden Classic, a college basketball doubleheader. Today's first game matching the Jayhawks of Kansas against the Minutemen of Massachusetts. The teams here today would do the Final Four proud, four of the top seven in the coaches' poll. Number one, UMass, number three, Kentucky, number four, UCLA, and number seven, Kansas. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Anaheim. Tom Hammond with Steve Jones and Matt Dukas, ready for what should be a terrific college basketball doubleheader. Matt, at UMass, ranked number one in the nation, first time in the school's history. They got there by thrashing Arkansas, and their reward was a week of 5:30 a.m. practices.
Well, the players told us yesterday they were a little confused about that kind of reward system, but there is no confusion as to why they're a very good basketball team. They have a couple of big-time talents. And take a look at the monster numbers that All-American Lou Rowe put up against the defending national champion. He was also 10 for 11 in that ballgame. And 6'11" sophomore Marcus Camby is an outstanding shot blocker that can erase a lot of mistakes. Now, UMass is a confident, happy, loose ball club right now, not only because they're number one, Tom, but because John Calipari promised them no more 5:30 a.m. practices.
Well, Kansas would have to get up pretty early to counter the athleticism of UMass, but they have some real size inside.
Well, there's no question that with size, you don't want to wake them up at 5:30, Tom. But when you've got a guy like Greg Ostertag, who is 7'2", 270, you expect him to bring his size and his strength inside. He has a chance to break the career shot block record. They're going to expect that today, as well as his scoring and rebounding inside. But this is a young team, and they've got to have the leadership of Jacque Vaughn, who equaled his career high in assists on opening game. A little bit hindered by injury problems, but he's expected to give him a big effort.
All right, coming up, back to New York, Hannah Sport with scores and highlights, then back to Anaheim for college basketball. The great man John Wooden is here as we await UMass and Kansas. Ostertag, 7'2", 270 pounds in the middle. Jacque Vaughn, the assist man, and Haas in the backcourt. UMass counters with Dante Bright and Lou Rowe, averaging 34 points a game. That's what he got against Cornus Williamson of the Arkansas Razorbacks. Marcus Camby in the middle, and in the backcourt, Padilla and Kellogg. John Calipari is the coach of the UMass Minutemen, and his seventh season has taken them to their first ever number one national ranking. And Roy Williams, the Dean Smith disciple, in his seventh year at Kansas, twice has been National Coach of the Year.
Seven is the story, but 7 feet is really the bigger story here, and that's Ostertag, and they've got to have a big game from him if Kansas is to knock off the number one team. And Kansas right now is up front. Their front line is going to carry it.
And a unique situation, no center circle, a center square here at the pond.
it's a guessing situation right off the bat. Of course, University of Massachusetts, their game is their defense. They want to create a lot of running opportunities from that defense and get the easy ones if they can. If not, why not go in their horse, Lou Rowe, who makes a lot of things happen. He draws the defense to him. He draws double team. And we can look for Kansas to change their defenses up quite a bit. I'm sure we'll see a matchup zone. And we may even see the big fella, Greg Ostertag, playing Lou Rowe in a one-on-one situation. He gives up a lot of quickness, but of course he has that big wide body that'll be difficult for Lou Rowe to get around or shoot over.
Matt, we've got a minute here. I want to ask you, as we look at young Lou Rowe here, can you remember when you were 6'5", 190 pounds?
Yesterday. I'm shrinking and losing weight.
Poetic license here, folks. We're adjusting some courtside problems here before we get the game underway, apparently.
We've got some equipment, extra equipment out here.
Now, as much as we've talked about the two big guns, Marcus Camby and Lou Rowe, the coaches of UMass will tell you right out that the key to their team is Derek Kellogg, their point guard, the senior, in that he sets the tone defensively, puts pressure on the ball. Important for him to not let Jacque Vaughn beat him on penetration. He also directs traffic out on the floor, runs the fast break, and of course gets the ball to the big people inside.
Kellogg is Calipari's coach on the floor, the co-captain and three-year starter. Ostertag against can be. And the Jayhawks control the opening tap. Chuck Vaughn at the point. Calling play number three. UMass man-to-man.
Camby didn't play the first time that they played a year ago, and Kansas won that ball game. But you can see how important he's going to be. He was able to get around in front.
Camby with a steal, and the Minutemen attack for the first time. Inside the Lou Rose, over Ostertag for the first two of the game.
Well, nice play by Marcus Camby there. Not known for his ball handling, although he can run the open floor very well. That time he did a nice little drive and kick to Lou Rose.
Pearson misses a three. Minutemen trying to add to their lead. There is Kellogg at the point. Dante Bright penetrates and scores. 4-0 UMass.
Well, Dante Bright does a lot of damage in the lane. He can shoot that little jumper 8 to 12 feet, which is so difficult. But you saw Ostertag staying very close to Lou Rowe, not going over to help out. He's going to have to try to do both.
Kansas in their half court.
Patience for Kansas is going to be the key. They want to get the ball to Ostertag and LaFrance up front. Shot clock now down at 10 as they try to reset.
Pass has a shot blocked by Kellogg, but Ostertag down with it, and he pounds it through. First basket for Kansas.
Well, the officials, I don't know what they were looking at that time. Pass had to force that shot. He got hammered on the arm, and just with 2 seconds left on the shot clock, Ostertag was able to turn it into a deuce.
Camby with LaFrance fronting him, loses it out of bounds. Turnover, Minutemen.
You have just been watering about the play of the Lou Rowe, and you can understand why. The power player inside makes an adjustment and is able to get the first 2 points of the ball game for the Minutemen.
Jayhawks looking to tie. Ostertag calling for the ball inside. Instead, penetration. Has tried to deal it back to LaFrance and loses it out of bounds.
The one thing that Roy Williams does not want from his team is turnovers and mistakes. That gets him walking to the other end. He wants a shot. He wants a lot of up and down play, but he wants a shot every time they get down there, and they've been down a couple times with turnovers.
Well, last year in New York in the preseason NIT, where they defeated, when Kansas defeated UMass, Roy Williams was concerned that he felt he almost lost the ball game because they mishandled the ball, but it was against the backcourt trap. They weren't prepared for that at the show.
Other pressure, and Vaughn gets a turnover and a conversion.
Kellogg lost it, and Vaughn made him pay. The game tied at 4.
They don't look for a lot of changing defenses on the part of Kansas after made field goals. Always looking to trap out of their man-to-man defense.
Bryce first miss. UMass gets it back.
Rebounding is supposed to be a big key for Kansas. If they can control the board, they will beat UMass. They beat them that way a year ago, but right now, the Minutemen are tripping through the ball. Another turnover.
Kellogg throws it away. 2-on-3. Jayhawks pass. Got it. Used his body to protect the ball and laid it through.
Well, one thing to force the turnover, which Kansas is doing right now, is some faulty ball handling by Massachusetts, but they're turning it into lay-ins at the other end.
Roll over Ostertag. 4 points for Lou Rowe. Game tied once again. Padilla with a steal. He'll beat Ostertag to the hoop. Ostertag blocked it. Taken back though by Norville into the game for UMass. And Rowe spotted for the three.
Oh! You see that UMass continues to get hands on the ball. They're a little bit quicker. Kansas gets a favorable bounce, and they make some substitutions. Good steal here by Vaughn. He's going to go and make a hard, aggressive push the other way. It turns into a good score for Hobbs. You know, we talked about Ostertag and his ability to block shots. They're going to need a lot of that.
What an effort by Big Ray, just picking him up and laying him down as he had to chase a very quick edge of Padilla to block that shot. I'm sure he's exhausted.
He thudded down the floor and made the play, though. Here's another UMass steal. Kellogg pulls up. That's a two. And it won't go. LaFrance rebounds for Kansas. Pass tried to run out. Manages to save it. Ostertag can't handle it. Both teams a little sloppy here last couple of minutes.
Turnover is a have been critical, but they haven't hurt Kansas yet.
The Jayhawks have turned the ball over five times in the early going.
We've Pond in Anaheim for the inaugural John Wooden Classic. The field this year, of course, for the John Wooden Classic is outstanding. It includes UCLA, Kentucky, and Kansas. Arguably three of the greatest college basketball programs of all time, but if they're the greatest, currently number one ranked UMass is the latest. You got to remember, they had the worst winning percentage in the 1980s of any college basketball program in Division I, and that was until John Calipari arrived. He has turned it around faster than Michael Eisner turned around Disney. And when we talked to former UMass star Rick Pitino about the turnaround and the number one ranking, he said, "I never thought I would see it in my lifetime." Tom?
All right, pleased to have Paul Sunderland with us on the sideline today. As Calipari directs a little traffic, we'll have our first free throws of the game. At the line for the Minutemen, Dana Dingle, the junior from the Bronx, New York, who had a career-high 20 points against Kansas in that preseason NIT meeting last year.
This is the Achilles heel of UMass, free throw. And that's what cost them a year ago.
It did, but what a free throw shooting performance against Arkansas last Friday night. 40 for 50. That'll win you a lot of ball games, Steve.
While we were just coming back from commercial, the fans here at the Pond, and it is sold out. There will eventually be over 18,000 in here. It's just after 10 in the morning, California time. But gave John Wooden a standing ovation. Wooden talking about young coaches yesterday, saying, excuse them for some of their histrionics, but excuse me for enjoying them, too.
Well, we talk about big-time talent that the Lou Rowe has. This spin move, watch how quick this is on Pollard. The big guy stands up, plays right into the hands of Lou Rowe. He's got that spin move. He's got the drop steps, the quick turnaround. He makes the most of his 6'5", 6'6", whatever you want to call him, down low. And he gets up into the air so easily and has big, strong hands. You know, we've had a lot of turnovers here in the first 4.5 minutes of this ballgame. And I attribute a lot to the teams haven't played that much. Last Friday night for UMass, last Saturday night for Kansas, so they've just been playing against one another. They are not as sharp as I'm sure they'd like to be.
Well, let's stretch Lou Rowe, because you know he's coming to see the pros, and he wants to get as big as he can.
6'7.5". How's that?
Rowe has a half dozen points, and UMass leads by 3. Pond penetrates, kisses it off the glass, and will shoot one.
Now, this was all that Roy Williams was talking about. I need Jock Vaughn. I don't know how he is. He has strained abdominal muscle, but this little guy leads him out on the floor, and you can see he can handle. He goes up against the defense of UMass, gets the field goal, and now the chance for a three-point play. Some mass substitutions, Tom.
Derek Kellogg committing the first Kansas foul, sending Vaughn to the line for the three-point play.
Now, Derek Kellogg can do a lot of good things defensively as long as he can keep his man in front of him, but he does not have the foot speed or quickness to stop a guy as quick as Jock Vaughn, who wants to make up his mind to beat him off the dribble. Derek Kellogg is going to have to make some adjustments.
Vaughn's three-point play ties the game at 9. Jock Vaughn with 5 of Kansas' 9 points. Quick shot up by Mike Williams. A 3, Mike Williams into the game and launches immediately.
That didn't take him long. Of course, he was suspended for the Arkansas game and the 2 exhibitions before that. So it was kind of a bittersweet feeling for him last Friday night when his team knocked off the defending national champions. But Mike Williams wants to get back into the fall.
Well, he did.
You know, Mike Williams could not make a shot yesterday. They ran several plays for Mike Williams, but he could not make a shot, and he comes in firing.
Sean Pearson with his first basket for Kansas. It's a 1-point game.
And that puts Kansas into their matchup zone.
John Calipari saying Kansas was a tough team to play early in the season because they tricked you. A lot of gimmick defenses especially. Pollard rebounds that miss.
Well, Ostertag won't get credit for a blocked shot there, but he certainly changed Kansas.
Pass with a three-pointer that won't go. Ostertag battling with Williams out of bounds to UMass.
That's what I like about Calipari.
That must be Jared Hess. Now we see him there. That's his game. He started out at Cal Berkeley, played with Jason Kidd over there, but this is his game, diving for loose balls. He'll get up a lot of skin.
Yeah, and he came a long ways to do that. He used to play baseball. That's a good slide, head first.
Head first. Just over 14 minutes left in the opening half from the Pond in Anaheim. UMass and Kansas in up by 1. Tapped in by Lou Rowe. That's 8 for Rowe.
Russ Williams' name on your belt, I guess Oscar tags can go on there, too.
I have a feeling before the season's over, there's going to be a lot of notches in that list of victims.
One thing that Camby does very well, and Oscar Tash can have to do a better job of holding this position, Camby uses his quicknesses around in front to front. They couldn't control that one, but he almost had a steal.
Well, Lou Rowe so active here, and especially against a zone situation, although Kansas has blockout responsibility, it's so much more difficult in a zone. In a man-to-man, you know who your guy is, you can put a body on him. You're supposed to tag the guy, touch him, but it's very hard to do in his own defense, and it'll open up a lot of offensive rebounding opportunities for UMass.
Vaughn with a tray to tie it. He's matched Rowe's total of 8 in the first half. Williams inside to Rowe against Ostertag. Back to Williams for the 3. Good position on the board by LaFrenz for the rebound.
I noticed a little look there by Lou Rowe back to Mike Williams. He was very patient there, threw the ball back out to Williams. Williams rushed the shot instead of throwing it back inside one more time.
LaFrenz off the offensive board, draws the foul, will step to the line for 2.
So as we look at Jacque Vaughn, who has taken over the offensive end of it, you can see he's got acceleration and not bothered by that injury problem at all. And LaFrenz did a good job of keeping that one alive, and he'll go through the line.
And that time he went by a very quick Andre Burks, who does not give up anything in a speed matchup to any player out there. He is lightning quick. He goes to the bench. As it appears, John Calipari right now senses that his team is not sharp. Nothing looks very crisp out there, so he's making a lot of substitutions, letting everybody know that they're going to have to mind their P's and Q's, do their job out there, or they're going to come to the bench quite often.
LaFrenz misses the first shot. Rafe LaFrenz from Monona, Iowa, population 1500. His first name, Rafe, was a George Pappard character in the movie Home from the Hill. Here's Rowe.
Lou Rowe wants to show about the 25 scouts that are watching this ballgame that he can step out at about 15, 16 feet, face the basket, shoot it, and if the big guy comes out to guard him, he can put it on the floor and go to the hoop. It's just that he's so strong at his post-up game that John Calipari wants him to mix it up a little bit.
Camby with a good block off of Ostertag for the rebound. UMass with the ball, up 1. Here's Rowe again against Ostertag. Back outside.
When he's in this position against Ostertag, he wants to do that. Put the ball on the floor. He got him up, but couldn't finish.
Camby missed the slam follow. Boy, he just went right by Ostertag that time, Lou Rowe.
Well, they're in that man-to-man situation right now, and there's just no way that Ostertag can play him out on the floor. A little head fake gets Ostertag leaning, but Lou Rowe is probably going to get double-teamed in that situation quite a bit, but he's a very patient offensive player. When he gets it inside, he'll throw it back out. But what Lou has to do is reestablish his position, except that he doesn't want to go in there against a 7'2", 270-pounder. He's probably better off stepping out at about 17 feet.
Rowe has 10 points here in the first half as UMass comes with its own 7'2" player, the senior Jeff Meyer.
Ostertag went out. He looked like he was really gassed, and Pollard's back in the ballgame, so they're going to try to spot him through this first half of play.
Jeff Meyer did not play in the Arkansas game, mainly because the front line of Arkansas does not fit his type of game. But against the bigger front line of guys like Pollard, LaFrenz, Ostertag, he can get in there and give John Calipari about 5 or 6 minutes.
Just under a dozen minutes left in the first half. It's been close throughout. UMass leads by 1. Jump hook by Pollard is no good. Waited in to get his own rebound and committed a foul. Scott Pollard from nearby San Diego, California, commits his second foul. We'll take a time.
The Wildcats take on the number 4 ranked UCLA Bruins. Next on NBC.
Welcome back to the pond in Anaheim, where UMass leads Kansas 16-15. And Lou Rowe closing in on Dr. J's record as the UMass top scorer. Rowe is the first Massachusetts All-American. Dr. J never made the All-America team. And by contrast, the great tradition of Kansas, they have had 9 All-Americans, 13 members of the Hall of Fame for Kansas connections.
Let's see how Pollard does defensively against Lou Rowe inside. He's quicker, probably not as strong, just got moved out there, and that one went in on the top.
Kellogg got the roll. 3-point UMass lead. Lou Rowe has hit 4 of his 6 shots. The rest of the team, 3 of 10.
that, you'd say, somebody better get on that guy. He's got 12 already. And, fellas, if you don't recognize Lou Rowe by now, let me show you his number 15 and lighten him up.
Well, Roy Williams knew this was going to be a problem coming in no matter what. But, of course, Lou Rowe has a lot of ways to beat you, not only in the open floor but in the half-court offense. If you put a guy the same size or even a little taller, he's going to take you down low. Against bigger guys, you can step out at that 15-foot mark.
Friend hits the baseline stop to pull Kansas within three. Marcus Camby returns to the UMass lineup, replacing Meyer.
They get a reset, the shot clock in college is at 35, and we'll see if the Kansas defense, which was forcing some turnovers earlier, can get some now and get back into a little bit more of an open court.
Padilla. Just inside the arc, Edgar Padilla with his first basket.
Well, again, Kansas went to the matchup zone, trying to plug the middle, not let anything go inside there for Camby or Rowe. Took a chance on giving the outside shot. Padilla drains it.
And Thomas in some trouble, got rid of it, and Vaughn recycles the offense. Vaughn pulls up and shoots over Padilla. Scott Vaughn carrying the Jayhawk offense. He has 10 points. Inside by Pollard. Here's Vaughn again, and he threw it away. Kellogg takes it the other end.
Padilla made a good scrambling hustle play and knocked that away from Vaughn, so they get a good defensive transition.
Camby against LaFrenz, and a holding call against Rafe LaFrenz. His first foul.
UMass getting out and running. Padilla ahead of the back. Good hustle by both LaFrenz and Pollard to get back there and take a swat at that shot. And going the other way, Edgar Padilla, after the UMass play, came back and flicked from behind Rick Pitino, sitting in the stand somewhere, appreciating that play. And of course, John Calipari, a Rick Pitino disciple, and a Larry Brown disciple as well, loved that kind of defense.
The one thing is that the Kansas front line is a plodding, thundering kind of front line, but they do make the effort to get back, and that's all Roy Williams can ask for. These guys are not dancers.
Great offensive board work by the Minutemen. They still have it. Wright can't get it down. Finally, Kansas with a board. Williams trying to take the ball away from Pearson. Jayhawks safely in the front court.
Pearson has got to give him some punch. He's a guy that can get 16 a game. Good play inside by Camp.
Andy with a block. Ball on the floor to UMass. Kellogg leads the break. Here's Williams.
Well, other than Ostertag out on the floor right now, both teams have their quicker, more athletic players in there looking to create things with their defense, get out and fast break as much as possible. As we're going to see an offensive foul by Mike Williams.
Mike Williams called for the push.
Kansas did not see Camby last year, and certainly that would have made a difference. He reacted, made a nice block. You see what the young guys have done in terms of blocking. Tom Bradley got the most, and Marcus Camby, a big effort in his rookie year as a freshman.
He's had some pretty fast company there. I know Calipari would like to see him put on about 25 pounds upper body strength on the one hand to help his bulk up. On the other hand, Marcus Camby might be gone if he does that.
That block shot total last season, a UMass freshman record. Ostertag made a good catch, and Camby fouled him.
Ostertag is one of those players that knows where his office is. He's in the paint. He very rarely gets out of there. At the offensive end, he just stays inside. They're trying to work the ball around. He's got good position here. The one thing he's going to have to improve on is holding that spot. He had him on his back. He let him off, but he stays in the paint.
And Kansas works at that. We watched him at practice yesterday. As they swing the ball around the perimeter, they would like Ostertag to just take maybe one big step up the lane there to ride his man Camby, who's trying to front, and he will get a better opportunity to catch. But the big fella has trouble because of the stamina problem.
Walking call and the seventh turnover for Roy Williams, Jayhawks. Calipari, you mentioned the Rick Pitino connection. Rick Pitino, of course, played at UMass. Derek Kellogg within three assists of passing him on the all-time UMass assist record, and very instrumental in getting John Calipari as the coach. Pitino jokes that in order to hire him, they had to ask him to make a contribution toward Calipari's salary. said he finally put his foot down with the selection committee and said, you're hearing some knocks on Calipari because of jealousy. Can be fouled as he went for the slam.
Well, it's early in the morning here at the pond, but that caught the crowd Marcus Camby really taking off at the launching pad there just inside the dotted line on the underneath out-of-bounds play, just unable to handle the basketball well enough and also fouled on the play. Well, watch Marcus Camby take off as Ostertag just not getting there in time other than to hit him on the with the body.
Camby misses the first free throw. That is five fouls against the Jayhawks. Freshman of the year misses two. Ostertag with a rebound. McGrath quickly into front court. Haas beats inside nicely. Good assist from Haas and the basket by B.J. Williams.
Well, that's what Kansas prides themselves on their ball movement and their player movement and their motion offense. But when they're trying to post people inside, they do a good job of locking and sealing and moving the ball crisply.
Lowe misses the putback as Ostertag made him alter his shot. And Kansas with a chance to take the lead. Kellogg with a reach-in foul. Well, maybe not a foul. We'll check it out.
You get a look at ball movement, player movement, and this is what coaches really like. When you get the ball back out, look inside, and they find Williams right at the rim.
UMass to you by Gillette. Coach Wooden remembers former Kansas All-American Wilt Chamberlain.
Chamberlain, I thought, was the most explosive, the most powerful player to ever play the game at that time, and I would still say that he is. I'm not saying the best. I'm just saying physically he's the most powerful, and I went along with those at the time, think probably there still was going to beat him when he went there, but that isn't always the answer.
And coincidentally, it was 38 years ago today that Wilt made his Kansas debut. He did turn a few heads, 52 points and 31 rebounds in his first game as a Jayhawk.
Yeah, those are numbers that are still numbers in Kansas, despite all of that tradition.
Ostertag with a jump hook draws the foul from Camby. Number two on Marcus Camby.
That was Ostertag's best offensive effort right there. He got a good post position and showed some quickness and got good extension to pick up that foul. Calipari was off the bench. He didn't like it. That means he's going to have to watch Camby, who gives him some inside presence because he got two.
Well, what he didn't like about it was the fact that Marcus Camby got caught behind most of this first half when they have been matched up with one another at that end. Camby has been able to either get all the way around or at least three-quarter and get on the top side. Anytime a guy 7'2", 270 pounds, gets you on his back, he's going to get a good shot opportunity.
Ostertag doesn't remind many of Wilt, but he does hold a number of Kansas records, including blocks. Misses two free throws, however, but the Jayhawks get it back. Can't shoot free throws. That is the only similarity between Craig and Wilt. There's a three-second violation call on the Jayhawks, and that will be their eighth turnover in the first half with 7:21 left.
Quick count. We used to see a little bit longer threes in the NBA.
Not this year, Steve.
Bob inside. Rowe can't get there, but it's batted around back to him. Ostertag with a block. Quick Craig Ostertag held his ground and blocked the shot. On the offensive end, Ostertag can be played with two fouls. Watches him lay it through, and Kansas goes up by one.
There's that position again, Tom, just going to the rim, getting Camby on his back, and with two personal fouls, Marcus Smart about to pick up the foul. Very smart there in finding his teammate, Lou Rowe, all alone underneath against the little trap.
How can you forget about Rowe? He has 14 points. Mishandled, but Ostertag jams it through. Half dozen for Big Greg.
Both of these teams like to run a lot of back picks in their half-court offense, and neither team is handling it very well. You would think they would, practicing against it so much, but neither team defending it very well.
Camby with an outside shot and a bad-looking shot. Pawn takes it the other way for the Jayhawks.
Big-time push, but they didn't get anything out of the transition.
Williams bricks a three, and Padilla.
again, Ostertag, although he was pushed out just a little bit, did have Camby on his back again. A terrible shot by B.J. Williams there, who is not known for his perimeter shooting. Could have been a little bit more patient in there and go inside. The Ostertag is probably going to need a breather in a couple of minutes. He is gassed.
B.J. Williams now taking up the defensive assignment on Rowe. Doesn't make any difference. High arching shot. Good for point number 16 for Lou Rowe. UMass back on top.
Rowe has got 15 of their 26. Another great play where they come off the ball, but they couldn't connect that time from Williams. Williams didn't make the catch off the Vaughn pass.
Kellogg for three. Kansas has it. Collision, and the foul will be on Kellogg of UMass. He and pass colliding, and Kellogg with a foul.
It doesn't matter who's guarding Lou Rowe at the present time. He's going over anybody that lets him get the ball down in the post area and cash it in. They've got to try to keep the ball away from him. Somebody's got to get around in front.
And when he gets it in that situation, somebody has to come down very quickly and double team. Nobody made a move as he put the ball on the floor once in the lane and got an easy-looking shot.
Kellogg committing a second foul. That's six against UMass. Kansas will shoot the bonus for the last 5 minutes of the half, but they turn it over. Norville up with the ball, gives it to Padilla. And here's Williams outside. Collides with Haas and the foul, blocking foul on Jarrett Haas of Kansas, his first.
Make no mistake about it, Mike Williams, anytime he catches the ball, he is thinking shot. He was ready to let that one fly. Pass was up on him, tried to beat him on the dribble before he made that pass. But Mike Williams, who does not shoot high percentages from anywhere, shot very poorly last year. Only about 28% from the three, 60 from the line, 41 from the field. For a guy who takes as many shots as he does average about 15 points the ball game, but he's got to shoot a better percentage.
Three-point attempt, no good, and a foul inside.
This is a guy you want to shoot. You would rather invite Mike Williams to shoot than keep the ball out of the hands of Lou Rowe. If you can, Rowe is out of the ball game right now. He's getting a quick breather. And if Kansas is going to make any kind of move to get control of this half, they got to try to do it while Rowe's on the bench.
And where you're really worried about Mike Williams is at the end of ball games. In his career, six game-winning shots, two of them against Temple last year. He has been uncanny at crunch time with the shot clock or the game clock winding down.
Seventh Kansas foul, number two on Haas, but Dingle misses the first end of the bonus, and Kansas takes it to the other end and scores.
Here's a nice extension and change of the shot for the score.
Well, John Calipari is going to have a lot to talk about at halftime. The transition defense of UMass in this first half has just been awful.
Four on two.
Inside, Connor got the roll.
Just does a great job of passing the ball off the wing, back into the middle, and right off the bench comes Lou Rowe.
And again, John Calipari says he said his team is tired. They're just not running well. They're not getting back. He's got to get his horse back into the ballgame.
Williams misses a three. Pearson outlets a Vaughn. Two on two. Great pass. Haas is fouled. Vaughn somehow threaded the ball right between defenders, and Haas looks like he is injured as he went to the floor hard. What a pass by Vaughn.
It was a beauty, Tom, and everybody in this building saw it coming. They could see it. It was a long, low bounce pass. Perfect to Haas, who just couldn't finish the play, mainly because Dante Bright made a terrific defensive effort there to try to block the shot and pick up the foul. But here is Kansas in transition again, as UMass very slow getting back. The big lumbering frontline players of Kansas are just beating them down the floor, and there's that defensive play by Dante Bright, but he picked up a foul on the play.
You thought he was hurt. Floor is part of his game. We should probably put Haas and move it over a little bit and then put floor between Jared and Haas, because this guy plays on the floor. He's one of those hustle players.
Haas, as you mentioned, the transfer from Cal Berkeley. Originally from South Lake Tahoe, California. That's the Kansas, California connection. He gets one of two. Haas is so serious he sometimes sleeps with the basketball. Padilla left open for a three and can't connect. The three-point attack has been poor for both teams here in the first half.
UMass very much prepared, however, for that trap after the free throw. They know it's coming. They know that Roy Williams likes to change up his defenses. They found the open man for the wide open shot. So far in this first half, and it has been for a while, Roy Williams' biggest concern is the offensive board power of UMass. They have seven of them in this first half, and they've only turned it into 2 points.
3:52 left in the opening half. It's been a close game throughout. Right now, Kansas has its biggest lead.
In a one-and-one situation now, as they've picked up their 17th foul on Hass and makes the first.
One of two. Offensive board with the Jayhawks, though. They can't get it through. Rowe with the rebound for UMass. Minutemen have missed their last six shots.
When in doubt, you've got to come back to the guy that's going to do it for you. Rowe missed.
Got it back. Missed again. Hass comes away with it for the Jayhawks. Made a save right to Bryce. Basket counts and a Kansas foul.
Now, sometimes hustle can work against you, and that time Hass did a great job of making a save. They always say, if you're going to make a save, throw it to the other end of the floor. As we look at the board work of Lou Rowe, he tried to get inside, couldn't get that one. Now the ball will come along, and you watch Hass try to control it and puts it right back to UMass, and they end up with a three-point play.
Free throw was good as well as Scott Pollard of Kansas picked up his third personal foul.
Time Anaheim, the inaugural John Wooden Classic, and a couple of gentlemen very distinguished in the Los Angeles basketball marketplace. Jerry West, of course, and Mitch Kupchak, the new general manager of the Lakers. You guys get good seats for these things. You're sitting right down courtside. Who are you looking at?
Well, you know, obviously we're here for really kind of an event. I think most of these players who have proven themselves already, people are aware of, but we're here just really enjoying the day. It's fun to watch good basketball.
You like Lou Rowe inside and out?
He's a good player. He's really helped himself, particularly, I think, shooting-wise. He's done a nice job improving his game. He's a good prospect.
Now, Mitch, you're general manager with the Lakers now, but go back a few years, and you were a Tar Heel. You look for them to be in this tournament pretty soon?
Well, you know, perhaps in the future. Obviously, they're not here right now, but they are represented with Roy Williams and Matt Doherty.
There are Tar Heels everywhere. Tom, back to you.
All right, Paul, I noticed Jerry West did a pretty nice little tap dance around the the Lou Rowe subject. Edgar Padilla committing the foul, and that is the 10th against UMass, which means two free throws for Kansas the rest of the way. 3:25 left, first half.
UMass applying their press after that timeout in the backcourt, and that's what Kansas had problems with last year in the preseason NIT. That Roy Williams had his team come out of the timeout very ready to attack it. They got a layup opportunity for Pearson as he goes to the line.
It's one of two. You saw Doherty, the assistant coach over on the Kansas bench. That's Roy Williams.
Didn't he attire you?
He was indeed.
As they said, they're everywhere. You can't get rid of those little feet. Ostertag coming back in the ball game right now. A chance for Kansas, again, with their bigger front line, and they keep moving people in and out to perhaps wear down the UMass Minutemen up front.
Kansas leading the nation's number one team. Here's Rowe against Ostertag. Pretty shot. 18 first half points for Lou Rowe.
He's showing us the whole package. We saw the quick spin move earlier that time. Just a little head and shoulder fake towards the baseline and the quickness beating the bigger Ostertag.
Position is everything when you're playing down on the post, and he gets a good position, and Ostertag is not going to be able to handle that. Little lockstep one way, come back the other. Ostertag pick up the foul at the other end of the floor. He's got two personal fouls.
Rowe, a strong candidate for the Wooden Award as College Player of the Year. Roy Williams sees his big man Ostertag commit the offensive foul, as you said, his second. And it will send Jeff Meyer to the line for the first time this season. He banked it in.
He called it, though. I saw it.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
I heard him.
That's why he didn't laugh.
Jeff, a senior from Wausau, Wisconsin, married, has a son, Jacob, that was born February this year. Long rebound. Right back to the Minutemen. Rose fadeaway won't go. Ostertag with his fourth rebound. Vaughn all the way, won't go. On the floor, picked up by the Jayhawks. Quick hands of Padilla, knock it out of bounds. 2:38 left, first half.
Good.
good quick reaction by Padilla to slap it away, and so Kansas will reset. The best play that Kansas has run in this first half been away from the ball and then get someone cutting through the hoop and try to come inside to LaFrance.
Missed the jump hook. Kellogg leads the break. Pulls up for three. Derek Kellogg with a three-point shot. He has five, and UMass recaptures the lead. Like the Minutemen have survived the cold shooting spell, come right back on Kansas.
Well, it has been a game of streaks for both sides, and it's trying to get the ball to Ostertag, triple team.
Kellogg came down to help. He just took it right to his fellow seven-footer Meyer. Banked at home and has a chance for a three-point play.
And John Calipari a little upset with Jeff Meyer right now. It feels even though he does not have a lot of athletic ability or quickness, he felt he had enough big body there to push Ostertag a little bit further out from that. Actually, he just backed away and gave Ostertag his excellent position inside as Kansas just started on the left side, swung it around. A little step inside by Ostertag to get good position.
They know where Ostertag is, and what they want to try to do is keep someone in front of him. He doesn't really react very well to passes, and the ball has to come right to him this time to get the three-point play.
Ostertag from Duncanville, Texas. His favorite sport growing up was baseball. He was a pitcher. Can you imagine? 7'2", right-handed pitcher.
His new meaning to the word, the high, hard one. Holy heck, imagine him throwing a leg up at you at 60 feet.
Kellogg misses the three, but the offensive board for the Minutemen. He's done a good job on the offensive glass. Dingle cuts to the hoop, and Rowe finds it.
And that's why this guy can be an All-American. He makes the other players better. He is unselfish. And when he recognizes that double team and UMass makes their cuts and their spot-ups, he will find that open man and deliver.
Minutemen have 10 offensive rebounds here in the first half. Three-point shot by Billy Thomas, the freshman from Shreveport, puts Kansas up by one. Just over a minute left in the opening half. Rowe. Vaughn came down to double team. Rowe got it back, missed. Ostertag might have gotten a piece.
Ostertag got a piece of his body, but they end up with another unforced turnover out of it. And this is the part that is driving Roy Williams just a little bit to the left of that bench. He told the team yesterday, get us a shot. I don't care, but let's not turn the ball over. They need to be reprogrammed. You see the number of turnovers there. They didn't listen very well in practice.
That was one of the things he told us. The key to beating the top-ranked team was get a shot every possession.
And they have been fortunate in this first half that a lot of those turnovers have not turned into that many easy baskets, but you still don't want to live that way. Lou Rowe must have been fouled on that last call the way he reacted to the officials. He went over to the referee and kind of opened up his hands begging as what do I got to do to get a foul, but I was interested to watch how Derek Kellogg, the senior, was very patient in there, throwing it into Lou Rowe. Lou didn't like what he had, pitched it back out, back inside of Lou Rowe before he made his move.
Hannah Storm standing by in our Prudential Update studio in New York. We'll have a feature on Kentucky coach Rick Pitino. A little John Wooden mini feature. Of course, one of the highlights of this day at the John Wooden Classic will be between games when Dick Enberg sits down for a lengthy interview with the Wizard of Westwood. Dick Enberg, of course, was the voice of the Bruins in John Wooden's heyday at UCLA as Coach Wooden looks on from the stands here in the first Classic and compiled a record of NCAA championships that will never be equal. Rowe over the double team. 20 in the first half for Lou Rowe.
This time against the freshman, Rafe LaFrance, and Roy Williams was concerned about starting Ray Fulham, and that's why he had Ostertag with him, and that's why, as a freshman, just does not have the body strength or the know-how to deal with a player like Lou Rowe.
14, Kansas turnover, gives the ball back to UMass with just over 35 seconds left in the half. And more turnovers for the Jayhawks. See if the Minutemen hold it for the final shot.
Who this ball is going to go to, and it's just a question of keeping Lou Rowe from getting his hands on it, making someone else try to shoot the ball.
Padilla penetrated, tried to find the roll, but the pass was too low and hot to handle.
Vaughn from half court off the rim. And so the first half has come to an end. Back and forth, it's been a first half full of streaks, and the top-ranked Minutemen of UMass will go to the locker room with a 39-38 advantage. And Paul Sunderland standing by with Coach Calipari. Paul?
Well, John, when you're ranked number one, you got a big target on your chest. We talked about that. Pretty good first half, a little ragged in the beginning, but when you have Lou Rowe, it sort of smooths things out a bit.
Yeah, he played well. You have to give credit to Kansas. I mean, they played inspired basketball. They're not backing down from our team, and it's a good lesson. And even in the early in the game, our players were saying, this is good for us. This is a great challenge for us. So we're happy with the first half.
They changed defenses on you several times, particularly in the first 10 minutes. Was that a concern for you and your guards?
Yes, it was. You know, I'm out coached about every game, so I'm just trying to get those kids to play hard and go after balls. And Roy's done a great job in the first half, and we're just going to try to come out and play hard, pick it up a little bit.
All right, if they play any harder, they're going to have to make the court a little bit bigger. Good luck in the second half, Tom.
Okay, Paul. So led by Lou Rowe with 20 points in the first half, the top-ranked Minutemen of UMass leads Kansas 39-38. Now to Hannah Storm in our Prudential Update studio in New York.
Thanks, Tom. Great game.
That first half could also be known as the Lou Rowe Show, as Lou pitched in 20 points in the first half. And Matt, Kansas really is fortunate that they don't trail by more than a point after 15 turnovers.
Well, Roy Williams' concern, which he preached about all week, was taking care of the basketball and offensive rebounds. Too many turnovers, 14, but UMass only scored 8 points of them. Too many second shots, 10 of them, but only 4 points. So on the one hand, his team earned the respect of UMass and only trailing by one, but they got away with murder.
Take us through the halftime stats, if you will. We'll pop them up there for you.
Okay.
There you go.
There you see the field goal shooting of Kansas, mainly because they've been able to get the ball inside to Ostertag, who's shooting, getting high percentage shots. UMass just not finding the mark, showing signs of the week off. And really, Lou Rowe, the only Minuteman able to get much done offensively. They're only a three rebounds for Kansas, but still too many offensive rebounds for UMass. Or I should say for Kansas, and there, the big turnover edge that Kansas has scored.
Matt, you talked about Lou Rowe and the fact that he got 34 in his opening ball game and is on his way to at least that kind of number if they can't keep him from getting that post-up position and do something about getting some help, because whenever he's been in a one-on-one situation, he has been able to do big-time damage. He has scored on every numbered jersey that Kansas has, so nobody out there can say, Coach, that wasn't Gardner. So he's put something on everybody. And you know, Tom, we can't get that coach out of Matt Gukas. He gave us a good halftime talk. Yeah, so Kansas is better, going to be ready to take care of the basketball.
Just a moment ago, Paul Sunderland caught up with Kansas coach Roy Williams. Paul?
With Kansas coach Roy Williams, pretty up-tempo game. Any answers for Lou Rowe right now? 20 points in 18 minutes.
Well, we've got to do a better job on Lewis, hopefully get him a little farther away from the basket and challenge the shot. But we've got to stop turning the basketball over. We had too many turnovers, and it looks at the stats says we're ahead rebounding, but I don't feel like we're ahead rebounding.
Right, but it has been a very physical basketball game. Do you think that will favor you if it gets very close down the end with Ostertag and Pollard and LaFrenz?
Well, I look out there, Lewis is pretty physical, too. I don't know. I think what we've got to do is stop turning the ball over, continue to get good shots on a break, and cut down on Lewis, and he's a heck of a player.
He is indeed. So is your team pretty good as well. Jacques Vaughn, I think, going to have the basketball in his hands a lot more in the second half. Back to you.
Okay, Paul, and Lou Rowe is the leading scorer in the game with 20 first half points, and the only other man in double figures for either team, Jacques Vaughn, with 10 for Kansas. And guys, in the first half, I think it was Matt that said Lou Rowe showing us the whole package today. Has your assessment of him changed any from seeing him play here in the first half?
Well, we're seeing a great basketball player. We saw him do it to Corliss Williamson and the defending champions last Friday, where he's seeing it against different people tonight. He can not only go inside, he is showing everybody that he can step outside, look at that jump shot. If somebody comes up, he can put it on the floor and go by.
Wright misses the shot right into the hands of Ostertag.
See if Kansas stays with some of that motion where they get the ball moved in a misdirection and then bring it back right at the rim, because that's where they've really been most successful, trying to get it into Ostertag's knocked away.
Rowe helping out because Ostertag had position on Camby, had him sealed off, but Rowe came over to help to knock the ball away.
And the reason he was able to do that is Rafe LaFrance, the freshman, came over and got in the way as Ostertag had excellent position, the rookie getting in the wrong spot at the wrong time.
Now Ostertag outside. That's a screen for Haas. His three-pointer comes up short. Padilla rebounds for UMass. Lou Rowe out on the floor with another shot. 22 for Rowe. You hear the crowd go,
when Lou gets his hands on the basketball.
The ghost attack has got to be wondering, what do I got to do? I got back into the defensive area. I plugged the lane, and here I'm guarding the 6'7 All-American who can take me just about anywhere he wants to go.
That time, it was the freshman, Rafe LaFrance, that had Camby pinned on his hip, laid it in, and drew the foul. Number three on Marcus Camby.
Big concern there, but good position. He's holding it very nicely. Able to get the ball, and it's a catch and turn. That's going to get Myers back in. Now, if you want to know what Kansas could do for Lou Rowe, they should pull the plug on us because he's TV Lou, and TV Lou has been wearing them out today.
That's what they call him. They say he saves his best performances for the national TV cameras. Meanwhile, Marcus Camby has gone to the bench with three fouls for UMass as the Friends completes the three-point play. Camby having a disastrous game. He is 0 for 5 shooting and just picked up his third foul. Lou Rowe, though, continues to operate. That one won't go. On the floor, picked up by Rowe. Ostertag blocks it. Here comes Kansas. Pass, bouncing the pass to Pearson, who lays it in.
Well, Lou Rowe has to be very careful here in not trying to carry the whole load himself. He's capable of scoring a lot of points, but he's at his best when he's scoring about 18 to 25 and getting his teammates involved. And right now, he's been unable to do that. And a big part of the problem is his teammates have not been doing much to get themselves open.
The one time they had a cutter going to the basket, he gave them a nice return feed, and they scored an easy two, but they haven't had a lot of cuts. This is when Kansas has been strong in transition. Good defense by Padilla.
Rowe back to Padilla. Rowe got the return pass and laid it in, and a Kansas foul.
Well, that was UMass basketball. Edgar Padilla, who has those hands on a pickpocket, knocking the ball loose and starting the two-on-one break with Lou Rowe, who gives it up at just the right time with the idea of, hey, if I give it up now,
I want it back.
I'm going to get it back. I better just give it to him quickly. Watch. And he's going to finish the play as he just overpowers Big Greg Ostertag.
And that is the third foul on Ostertag. Rebounded by LaFrance. Ostertag stays in the game with three. LaFrance cuts to the basket for the easy one. He has eight.
If Kansas is going to win this game this afternoon, it's going to be on those kinds of plays, transition and beating them back and attacking the rim.
Wright penetrates and scores.
And you can tell John Calipari is furious about it, and it just shows that right now his team is just not alert in transition defense.
Ostertag against Meyer. Missed it. Rebounded by Bright. Rowe driving on LaFrance. Ostertag picked him up. Blocked the shot to the right to Meyer. Meyer against Ostertag. And that'll be four fouls on Greg Ostertag. Big point of the game with 17-18 left. Ostertag picks up his fourth.
Here's a good shot on the free throw, and then that outlet pass. As Rafe LaFrance just blew by Jeff Meyer, who has a difficult time running the floor, but right now Jeff Meyer at the free throw line, and John Calipari happy for what he did, drawing that fourth foul on Ostertag, and not a smart foul by Greg, as Jeff Meyer is just not an accomplished offensive player. He probably should have tried to make him shoot that ball over his outstretched arm.
Are you trying to say we could leave him in there by himself and he wouldn't get? Oh, he missed both of those free throws.
I didn't say that.
UMass got it back. Pollard has replaced Ostertag. Vaughn on the fly. Pass. Padilla with a long rebound.
you can tell that UMass is not a team that really likes to transition. They make more mistakes in the open court than Kansas does. Kansas trying to stay in a speed game and take advantage of their execution.
Kellogg kicked it. It'll go back to the Jayhawks. Roy Williams' team. Tied with UMass at 45.
Well, there's no question this morning they have not been a good transition offensive team, but guys like Dante Bright, Dana Dingle, Padilla, they can get out there and run. It's just that they're not crisp with their ball handling right now.
And it's Norville into the game, the 6'8 freshman from Fayetteville, North Carolina, has a few minutes in the first half. Inside, Williams, shot blocked by Norville. Padilla, front rim, rebounded by Pollard. Outlet to Vaughn. Pearson. Offensive board, half, nice fake, got it through. Made Norville leave the floor and had the easy bucket.
Well, Roy Williams was not happy with their rebounding effort in the first half, said so, and they seem to have taken him to heart. They've done a better job of going after misses and getting second opportunities.
Jayhawks by two, 16 minutes remaining. Rowe trying to jockey for position with B.J. Williams, who has the defensive assignment. Finds Norville open from 15.
That's what you want to do. Make somebody else shoot the ball other than Lou Rowe, and they throw it out to Norville. Maybe he and Myers are buddies. They need.
First foul on Lou Rowe. It comes with 15:44 left. 47-45, Jayhawks. Monday Christmas comes to Kansas, leading UMass, 15:44 left. And, of course, tomorrow we'll turn our attention to NFL football, starting at 12:30 Eastern with NFL Live. And I don't know if you Hoops guys follow the oblong ball sport or not, football, but we have a rematch of that classic Monday night game with the Chiefs and the Broncos coming your way tomorrow. That was one of the greatest games ever.
That was a huge come-from-behind win. You know, they got a little bit of concern about Joe Montana, whether he's going to be there to lead them back. But, you know, John Elway, he's got to go.
That was some game. And in that first game, the Jets and the Patriots, you know, Greg Parcells finally has his team playing somewhat the way he liked. Maybe it was those 2 years with Marv Albert. Came all those.
That's what drove him back to coaching.
All that football insight.
NFL starting at 12:30 Eastern time with NFL Live tomorrow. They'll keep you up to date on the latest from Joe Montana. And then NFL action for you here on NBC. Three-point shot by Haas won't go. Roll with a rebound for UMass. Massachusetts has 15 more field goal attempts than Kansas. Six more offensive rebounds. They just can't shoot it very well. There's a putback for Lou Rowe. He has 26.
That was a man in there grunting and groaning that time and cleaning things up for UMass to tie the ball game up. I mean, Lou Rowe has been everything for Calipari this afternoon.
They say Pollard hit it last. UMass will get it back.
Well, B.J. Williams catching up with Lou Rowe inside. Nothing he can do. B.J. just does not have the physical strength or the physique to deal with Lou Rowe as Lou just shed him and finished off the play of the last.
Marcus Camby. Bad-looking shot over Pollard. Camby is 0 for 6 in the game. Mike Williams committing the UMass foul, going after the loose ball. And Mike Williams, as you mentioned earlier, Matt, suspended for the first three games of the Minutemen. The Boston Globe and then Sports Illustrated writing a story about some academic difficulties with the Minutemen, saying some of the players were not making satisfactory academic process, didn't have high enough grade point average. And Coach Calipari responds by saying 75% of his players graduated.
And a big part of that controversy was the fact that the grades were printed in the newspaper, but Calipari and the staff have really almost turned that thing into a positive. It kind of brought the team together in that bunker mentality, us against them. And he's proud of the way that his team has responded in the classroom. And most importantly, and they feel good about what they're doing right now. What it served to do is hurt everybody up, the coaching staff, the academic advisors, and the players. I think it's going to turn out fine for them.
Lou Rowe called for steps, so the Minutemen turn it over to Kansas, with the Jayhawks leading by two.
Barry's not going to perk up unless he gets some calls at the other end for Lou Rowe. He feels that he got pushed inside the last time
when he got called for traveling after turnover for them, and Kansas now trying to set. Pollard does a good job, a better job, actually, of holding his position inside than Ostertag was doing, and they're trying to work for inside post play for LaFrance or Poppel.
I think you pretty much have to play zone defense a guy against Moreau, and they are ready for that. Hey, they see some of the best zone in the country with those Temple. Last year they played him three times, and John Calipari, Bill Banner were telling me that Temple has made them a good zone attack team, but that's an excellent zone that they play. But other teams can probably find and will, especially the way they can, different ways of zoning up to try to keep the ball out of the hands of Moreau.
That John Chaney Temple matchup zone is legendary. Here's Rowe operating against Pollard, who commits the foul.
Every time it has come inside to Lou Rowe, he has been able not only to hold his position, but to make something happen. So they've got to try to either get around in front of him or have pressure on the ball so they can't make that entry pass, because if Rowe gets it, he's going to hurt you. The numbers, they continue to mount. And, you know, he's better than a point a minute right now. And we got 13 of these babies to go.
Rowe, a good free throw shooter, too. He hit 10 of 11 against the Razorbacks. And he is slowly but surely getting the Kansas front line in foul trouble. That's the third on Scott Pollard. Ostertag already on the bench with four.
And he had a politic mark for that last one. He banged into Scott Pollard. Probably was fouled on the play, but throughout this morning, afternoon in the East, he has been begging pretty hard with the officials. But he's a rough customer inside. He draws a lot of contact. He initiates it.
Game tied at 49.
When they come out of this set with the big man up, they come back with screens. They're looking to get the ball inside, and we'll find out whether they're able to do it.
Vaughn with a baseline drive on Mike Williams. Dished it off. But a UMass foul is called. It is on Williams. His fourth foul.
He knew it was a bad foul. He knew he was going to the bench as Edgar Padilla comes in. Just a little hand touch, a little hand check, shading him towards the baseline to his big shot blocker friend Marcus Camby. But that's what the officials are calling this year. Much more emphasis on the hand check on every level.
PDA has been a sensation. Put back there by LaFrance. He has double figures.
France has been the story in the second half. 7 points to keep Kansas on top by two.
Kellogg, closely guarded by Vaughn, got away from him and pulls up, won't go.
Now, Derek Kellogg is looking around for Lou Rowe out there. He's not there. He's sitting on the bench. He doesn't know who to go to right now, so he's going to take it upon himself to put up a couple of shots. But I think UMass is going to have to get Marcus Camby somehow involved offensively. He's not known as a low-post player, but he can step out at about 15 feet, take that jumper, or drive it to the basket.
Vaughn has a penetration, found Pollard for the 12-footer. Bright answers for UMass.
If it isn't Camby, it has to be Bright, but they have to have another score after on the floor to keep the game close, and it has been close throughout in a game of three, Kansas by two.
Camby with the interception, fell out of bounds, made a good defensive play, but couldn't quite hold on. Kansas will get it back.
Called a timeout, I think that's the reason.
Did he call
he
a timeout as he was sailing out of bounds?
Let's see.
He's asking for timeout, I think.
He called time and was able to get it.
So he averted the turnover.
The John R. Wooden Classic is brought to you by Braun Electric Shavers for the world's most recognized shave. By Miller Red Dog, bold yet smooth, unusually easy to drink. This is Red Dog territory. By Eagle, test drive an Eagle Vision at your local Eagle dealer. And by Sears Craftsman, a line of 1,600 hand tools made in America. Guaranteed forever, only at Sears.
Welcome back to the John R. Wooden Classic. Kansas over UMass right now by two. And John Calipari, UMass coach, made 3 points during that last timeout. One was, hey, look, fellas, Lou Rowe is the only player on our team that's going to the offensive glass. Kansas is solid. Changing defenses, they're going to block you out. Don't stay blocked out. Secondly, release the ball out on the break after we get the ball off the defensive board. You guys are dribbling it up and slowing things down too much. And also he said, let's run. It's Kansas that's running. It's UMass that's just jogging up the court. Play as hard as you can. If you get tired, I will get you out. Tom?
All right, Paul. Padilla with the shot clock down to one. Gets the bucket to tie the game at 53.
Well, Kansas came out one of the rare times in their 1-3-1 defense. They don't want to play that against when Lou Rowe is in the ballgame, and they still came out on the jump shot.
And coaches always say, I will get you out. Players say, but you won't get me back in.
Scott Pollard with a jam and a quick shot by UMass won't go. Pollard with a rebound as Bright missed. Collision under the basket and a UMass foul.
Well, this has been the difference in the second half of play. It has been the transition and open court play of Kansas. Kansas has been able to strike quickly, and after down at the other end, they get Pollard dive into the basket, and he throws it down. So with Ostertag on the bench, they really haven't lost anything with their inside play. Pollard and LaFrance have certainly picked up well. Roy Williams gambling now, four fouls on Ostertag. He's coming back in with just about 10 minutes to play.
There is Big Greg playing with four fouls.
Well, maybe he's not gambling because the other guys are playing so well.
So
if you're going to do anything, Greg, you better do it now.
Pass missed the first free throw, which draws a wry smile from Roy Williams. 6 points. And now seven as he rolls it in.
Lou Rowe is back into the ballgame. We'll see what kind of defense Kansas puts up this time. That 1-3-1 zone again, which will give up some wing shots like that.
Wright, Ostertag tried to keep from committing his fifth foul. He did, but conceded the basket to Bright.
And the other problem with playing any kind of zone defense, whether it's the matchup 2-3 or the 1-3-1, you do leave yourself vulnerable in the offensive board because you don't have strict blockout for responsibility.
Matt, you don't sound like you like the zone.
Well, I like parts of it, but I don't like the rebounds that you give up, especially to a good offensive rebounding team, and that's what Roy Williams and his staff are most concerned about. But when you're playing against a guy like Lou Rowe, you have to distort your defense.
UMass has 14 offensive rebounds, but they've gotten only 8 points off. Vaughn hit it over Brooks.
Vaughn, who had 10 in the first half, made his real good offensive effort, and that's the first one where he's even looked at the basket.
Slapped away. Vaughn has it taken back by Padilla, and then he is over and back. Backboard violation by Edgar Padilla after he made the steal.
Well, as advertised, Edgar Padilla has very, very quick hands. Always reaching in there. This one is not loose. First by Kansas, but Padilla not giving up on the play, comes from behind to hook for that ball right back.
But he steps across the line, so all of that for nothing, but it's a good aggressive play by him, and they're going to need that at the defensive end.
Just under 10 minutes left. It's been close to up. LaFrance off the lob pass from Vaughn. He has a dozen points.
They are wearing them out with misdirection. They go away and then have a cutter go into the basket. And those big guys have been open, and it's been LaFrance and Pollard here in the second half.
And it's so difficult to draw a back pitch because you cannot get up into your man and make contact, or else it's a foul.
Ostertag battling with two Minutemen underneath. He made Roe alter his shot, which came up short and got a piece of the putback. Finally, a Kansas foul.
This is what Kansas has been living off of. They take the ball away and then bring it back. And it's been LaFrance and Pollard over the top. This time, Ostertag gets a piece of that shot. The Minutemen will get it back. Ostertag gets it again, and he goes to the floor. And somehow, Lou Rowe gets his hands on the ball, and they foul him. Ostertag comes out.
That foul was on LaFrance, his second. A near steal by Pass. There are 14 fouls on Kansas, 5 on UMass.
Kansas looks like a very confident team right now. Their bodies look much more alive. They're quicker to loose ball. Very much in tune with each other right now. And UMass looks a little confused. Other than Lou Rowe, who's been able to fill it up, they look out of sorts right now. John Calipari said to them.
He looks out of sorts, and he's looking to the officials for direction. Those are the wrong guys.
They're not going to help you.
Rowe going to the offensive board is called for his second foul.
Pressure by UMass. Let's see if that changes things for Kansas. But Kansas has been able to control things because they've been able to move the ball, move people, get them going to the basket.
Nice cut by Hass. Pollard laid it in.
Well, this is really what makes Kansas a better team than the sum of the parts is their motion offense. They wear you down. They move the ball with crisp passes. They move their bodies on short cuts. And it's just so difficult to defend, especially when you don't see it that often. And they do it as well as anybody. And this is relatively a young team. They have experience, but it's young experience. What, six of the first nine players are freshmen or sophomores.
And Roy Williams likes the team, and he likes the fact that they're playing in this kind of a doubleheader because it will give them experience later.
Dante Bright cuts the lead back to five. The seven-point bulge was the Jayhawks' biggest. Collision and foul at Padilla of UMass. And that's number seven on the Minutemen. We'll shoot 1+1.
Well, here's what we're talking about. The ball movement of Kansas, good spacing, quick, sharp, short passes, about 15 to 18 feet. And Hass never stopped moving on that curl cut. Got into the lane and a little easy dish for the lay-in. Well, we saw Edgar Padilla find a way to stop the back pick. He pushed the back picker to the floor. He said, oh, you're not going to set a back pick this time. You're out of here. I'm throwing you to the floor.
Well, it's a one-and-one situation now for Garrett Hass. This is the first time he's been at the free throw line in the second half.
He's only hit 3 of 6 at the strike of the game. Now 3 of 7, but it was kept alive by Williams, and Kansas gets it back.
When you give people a second chance, the missed free throw by Hass and D.J. Williams out hustling Leo to keep that ball alive turns into another field goal. Roy Williams very happy with it, but I'm sure John Calipari is storing all this up. They will look at the tape, and I would not want to be in the next UMass practice.
They may go back to 5:30.
Not be 5. Could be 4:30 at this rate.
5:30 and 5:30, before and after.
Now, here's something to ponder. Should Kansas win and knock off number one, do they become number one?
That's what happened when the Massachusetts beat Arkansas, of course, which was then number one. But Kansas has six other teams ahead of them at the moment.
That's right. UMass is coming from the number three position. Of course, that's why the pollsters get all that big money to make those kinds of decisions. There's no question it'll move Kansas up a little bit higher. But we're in the infancy of this season. It's great to see four outstanding ball clubs, which we're going to see today in this particular setting, but we're a long way from the meat of the season.
Lou Rowe now with 29 points and 9 rebounds. Pass, Stephon Kellogg, fed it to Pollard. Couldn't finish, and it's tapped in.
Pollard has been huge here in the second half with his inside play. 10 second half points, but he's been around the goal. That's made a big difference for Roy Williams' team.
Pollard from San Diego, but played his senior year in high school in Washington. He's Washington Player of the Year. His homecoming has been big, but Kellogg slices three off that lead. 8 points for Derek Kellogg.
Their motto on the back of their jersey for the Minutemen is refuse to lose, and they got 7-17 to make it through.
Pollard couldn't handle the pass. Here's Williams the other way for the Minutemen. They're down 5. Williams launches a three. On the floor, Hass lost it. And the Minutemen will set it up.
Both teams look a little winded right now. They're getting seeing good play from really the Kansas star, Josh Vaughn, who really wasn't expected to play. He got hurt last Saturday. He has that strained abdominal muscle, same thing Charles Barkley has. So courageous performance by him today. But Carroll Hass has done a terrific job of keeping the ball moving. He's got that experience. He's a transfer from Cal, sat out last year. He's just very confident out there, other than some missed free throws. Been a lot of good plays out there.
Is that a timeout with 6:43 Lumbers? Coach Wooden reflects back on former Massachusetts great Julius Erving.
First time I saw him, I was absolutely amazed at by the way he seemed to hang in the air and how he could change and his twists and turns. And I thought his the hang time, a reminder, I'd only seen one other that I thought was very similar. That was Elgin Baylor prior to him. He had that tremendous hang time, was great too. But Julius was just amazing with what he could do, but he's just a fine person.
We think of Dr. J, of course, as the great professional player, but it's interesting to note he was never even named All-American during his career at UMass. There's the only Minuteman that's been named All-American, Lou Rowe.
Not All-American, Hall of Fame.
Thank you very much. Hall of Fame. Lou Rowe has 12 field goals. The rest of the Minutemen, the entire rest of the team, only 13. And Kansas is out shooting UMass 57% to 38%.
Again, it's the inside post position that Kansas gives up that cost them. Rowe goes up, changes the shot. Pollard said he didn't foul him. The official said that can't be so. And Rowe goes on the line. Both teams now in the one-on-one. This is a two-shot situation for Lou Rowe.
And, of course, Pollard, who has been such a key factor in Kansas taking the upper hand in this half, will go to the bench with his fourth foul. Rowe now has hit 5 of 8 at the free throw line as Pollard and Williams go out for Kansas. Lou Rowe grew up in Atlantic City. Had 3 sisters. His mom had to take 2 jobs to support he and his sisters. There's Marcus Candy with a putback. That's his first basket of the game.
Big effort and makes it a 3-point ball game again when it looked like they'd come away with nothing in that possession.
Candy with a block. Marcus Candy has suddenly come to life for the Minutemen. Candy posting on Ostertag. And the ball stolen by LaFrance. Gives it up, gets it back, and then it's fouled by Rowe. Third foul on Lou Rowe, who made sure LaFrance did not finish.
Well, the two things that all of those in the professional ranks will be watching, the reaction time of a player like Marcus Camby. It looked like Pearson had a clean shot on that one. He got to it very quickly, and then the unselfish play of the Kansas players, and LaFrance went in strong. Lou Rowe hammered him to the ground.
That was a frustration foul as Lou Rowe just mishandled the ball at the other end. LaFrance, with a little give and go, got the ball back, and a very hard foul on the part of Lou Rowe. LaFrance very happy to collect all his bones and get back to the free throw line.
Well, during Roy Williams' tenure at Kansas, they have made a habit of knocking off number one teams 2 out of 3. They beat Indiana in 80 and 93, and 90 Oklahoma got the measure of them, but 3 times Williams has faced teams ranked number one and twice has come away victorious. That's what he's decided among active coaches.
If you're Kansas, you want to make UMass have to use some time to get any kind of score because the clock becomes their ally with the 4-point advantage.
5:48 left.
Going against the 1-3-1 zone right now, just moving the ball around the perimeter. Of course, the 2 most vulnerable spots are in the middle of any zone and on the baseline. UMass not really attacking either of those areas at this moment.
Lou Rowe kept that one alive, so they get a reset on the clock, and they'll try again, and the guy who ought to try to get in it is Marcus Camby.
Ostertag rebounds the miss by Bryce. Kansas has the ball, up 4.
All those people came out from Kansas and said, you're great, and you know you don't handle the ball.
Pass looking for Ostertag. Lobbed it over Camby, but Camby got a piece of it, and the Minutemen take it the other way. 2-on-2. Williams spins. 2-Rowe missed it. Rowe still keeping it alive, but it's on the floor to Vaughn. Pass. Left wide open. Can't make it.
That would have been a huge basket. It looks like UMass is very slow in transition right now. That would have given them a 6-point lead, but both teams seem to be near the end of their tank.
In fact, John Calipari will call a timeout as his team does appear winded. 4:33. The John Wooden Classic and 1-800-Flowers are pleased to announce that $1,000 worth of holiday flowers will be donated to each participating school's medical center. Compliments of the Wooden Classic and 1-800-Flowers. From the pond in Anaheim, Tom Hammond, Steve Jones, Matt Dukas, Paul Sunderland. First of our doubleheader, with UMass and Kansas battling back and forth. Kellogg misses a 3.
It'll be dingled over the back, and that means they'll be walking to this end of the floor. No, they don't.
Run. To this end of the floor.
I guess when you're that young, you can waste a little bit more energy, but you can see LaFrance, who has been very big for Kansas here in the second half of play,
play, had good inside position, and that's one of the things that Roy Williams really talked about at the half, and this freshman has responded.
Got the roll. The Friends played on the North team in the Olympic Festival last summer after scoring nearly 2,200 points in his high school career. And he has 15 points in this game.
Wanted to show he could shoot that ball the same way twice, bounced it in, that's four corners twice, but they both counted.
Very hard to do. 11 for 20 for Kansas as a team. Massachusetts shooting poorly as well. 8 for 19 for the free throw line.
Williams double punched it through. Mike Williams has five off the UMass bench. Dante Bright returning to the UMass lineup, replacing Dana Dingle.
Calipari telling his team to rebound, and we'll find out whether Kansas just keeps moving the ball, moving people, and looking for inside stuff. Off of this set, this is what they try to do. They like to back pick screen with the big guys and then drop it inside to either Ostertag or Friend.
Lou Rowe kind of playing a one-man zone, and they're clogging up the middle and blocked that shot.
Good idea by Bond to try to catch him by surprise.
Three-pointer won't go by Bright. Here's Hoff with a run out against Bright. He got a jam over Dale, over Dante Bright. Wow, he pounded that one down.
And that all happened because the UMass guards are getting themselves out of position at the offensive end and not protecting one another. Neither is the small forward. Now Dante Bright helping as far as getting back in transition defense.
Calipari knows his team is struggling. He's looking, and he makes some switches, but you can see how he measures the defense and says, not this one. There will be no block here today. And it's been the hustling Jayhawks that have really been more alert and quicker to the ball here in the second half.
And really all afternoon, all morning, wherever you happen to be, they've been taking advantage of that because the guards for UMass have just not protected one another in that area. And Kansas, not known as a fast team, although Josh Vaughn is very, very quick. It's just they run in a smart basketball way, take advantage of situations.
For the UMass Minutemen, ranked number one in the nation for the first time in the school's history, could have a short reign as number one, 1 week to be exact, as they trail Kansas with 2:45 now left. Kansas working the shot clock down. Vaughn has it stripped by Williams, and UMass has the turnover. That's 22 committed by the Jayhawks. Hesitation move to Rowe. Foul by Ostertag, and he'll exit the game. Greg Ostertag will foul out with 2 minutes 32 seconds left. He leaves the game with 9 points, 5 rebounds, and 6 block shots.
Lou Rowe was clapping his hands and trying to remind Mike Williams, hey, I'm the go-to guy on this team, and if we get in trouble, we need to send it down here. Big effort for Ostertag in the shot-blocking area. We talked about that at the beginning of the ball game, protecting the inside. But penetration and then a little slip pass. Ostertag can't react and picks up the personal foul.
The challenge in there by Ostertag actually made Lou Rowe clutch a little bit and pull it back. He just couldn't keep his arm straight up. And if you were the Massachusetts coaching staff on that last play, you kind of had your heart in your throat with Mike Williams coming down on an open floor. They probably thought he was going to raise up and shoot a three. He showed good poise that time. Kept the control of the basketball. Little half penetration. He knew where Lou Rowe was the whole time. Got the basketball. He got a big point on the side. Out of the game is Greg Ostertag.
Rowe reaches 30 points. He's hit 6 of 10 at the line.
11 in the second half, so they've done a better job of making him work harder to score. Now they come out with pressure. 2:30 to go in the ball game. Still time for them to get back in it and maybe pull this out.
Trail by four. Franz made a good catch. Prevents an over and back violation. Kellogg with a reach in foul says what? That's his fourth.
A little hand check, a little touch foul. The officials have tried to be as consistent as possible with that throughout this ballgame. Darren Kellogg not happy with the call. They're trying to increase their pressure. Force some turnovers so they can get down and get some easy baskets because in the half court,
it has been very, very difficult all game long for Massachusetts to get good shots for anybody other than Lou Rowe.
Yeah, they have reached 10 team fouls, so it's an automatic two-shot situation for Haas and the Jayhawks. He made the first anyway.
Cap the second. 13 points for Haas. The Kansas lead is 73-67.
Now they're in a zone situation, and it's going to be up to UMass to make some shots. All they want them to do is use time and trying to get a scoring effort as they watch the clock tick down.
Rowe with a touch pass, shot clock to nine as Williams nails a three.
There you go.
Well, good patience on the part of UMass there, but moving it around, finally got it to the middle of the zone, and then made another quick, crisp pass to get that open shot for Mike Williams. Anytime against that zone, if you get into the middle or the baseline, you'll get a good shot.
It is a three-point game because of that. And again, when you talk about a guy delivering under pressure, that seems to be Mike Williams' name, and they're pressuring the Jayhawks right now.
He usually does it when there's about 1 second left.
Well, he's still got a chance. Three on the shot clock.
Vaughn is fouled by Williams. Made the good head fake. We'll have a two-shot opportunity at the line, and Williams has fouled out of the game. So there goes your potential game winner with his sixth game-winning shot in his career, fouling out.
You always talk about staying on your feet, and little guys never block shots anyway. So why did he go for that against the shot clock? That's what Calipari wants to know. You can see the reaction of Vaughn. We got him under control.
Especially with 1 second to go. If he's going to make that shot, let him make it, huh?
Sure. Mike Williams not aware of the clock situation or anything like that. He's just out there trying to get himself involved, play as hard as he can. He went for the little eyebrow fake. And Jacques Vaughn did a terrific job of just waiting, taking the hit before he goes to the line.
Well, I hope you've enjoyed this game, number one against number seven. And still to come, it'll be third-ranked Kentucky against fourth-ranked UCLA in the second game of our John Wooden Classic. Kentucky and UCLA, two magic names in college basketball, squaring off next. And, of course, don't miss our between games feature as Dick Enberg talks to John Wooden, the Wizard of Westwood.
So, Tom, in that second game, you think we'll see any more eyebrow things?
I don't know.
That's a classic.
That's a new one on me, which is interesting because he had his back to us. I don't know how Matt knew.
Well, we're going to see a blur out there. I know that, the way those two teams like to go up and down the floor.
Vaughn taking his time, sighting and hitting.
John Vaughn, he had 11 assists in the opening ball game. He has 10 today, so he has done his job of directing their offense and also providing some offensive punch, trying to get to 14 with this free throw.
He is a California native from Pasadena, John Muir High School. Set a California high school record with 400 assists at the game.
All right, Matt, now you're the coach. How quickly do you have to see this ball come in the air if you're UMass?
Rose just goes the double team.
I don't even have to answer, Steve. That's all you got to do. Take it down there. Get
Kansas
it.
Leading UMass 75-72. That timeout taken by the Minutemen, their last timeout. Kansas with a full complement left. Remember, Marcus Camby sailing out of bounds after an interception, called a timeout to save the turnover. And that could be costly for Calipari's Minutemen here down the stretch in the final minute.
Now they come back with wall-to-wall pressure with Camby as a safety. We'll see how Kansas handles this coming down the stretch.
Trapple Vaughn, who tipped his way out of the traffic. He knocked one of the Minutemen flying and now brings it into front court.
It was an adventure, but they got it up there, and they were afraid that UMass was going to apply that kind of pressure more because that's what they saw last year. UMass just didn't do it today.
Kansas now content to work the clock. At what point will UMass have to foul?
Well, UMass doesn't have the one-on-one working for him, so any foul is going to be a two-shot situation.
UMass Minutemen.
Now the coach said run down here, and they wanted to walk in and but they're now huddling as they've got the game under control.
Well, you couldn't get a much better possession of that under these conditions. Used all but about 6 or 7 on the shot clock as Hess popped open beyond the three-point line as he has played a solid basketball game in every area today. And even though he's only listed as a sophomore, he has played like a senior today.
And he has 12 in the second half, and in the hustle area, he's been huge. And really, that hustle is really what got Kansas control of the second half of play and got all these Jayhawkers here up dancing.
Rock Chalk Jayhawk will be the chant as LaFran steps to the line, shooting for his 16th point. He's had a big game. The freshman making an impact in a hurry, already has been voted the preseason Big 8 Freshman of the Year and living up to advanced billing.
I saw their game last week against San Diego. It looked like Rafe was out there thinking, and you can't just go out and play and think. Looks much more comfortable today. He's coming of age.
The Jayhawks about to pull the upset of the top-ranked team.
This holiday, trust NAPA to keep your vehicle running and help you save. Get a NAPA toy truck with battery-operated powerboat for only $16.99.
For the highlights, watch it live on NBC.
Just over 18 seconds left, and Kansas will upset the top-ranked team in America, the UMass Minutemen. Of course, they want to come down, get a quick three, and then come back and foul if they possibly can. Padilla with a miss, and then LaFran picks up the basketball and pays the penalty as he is fouled. Doc Vaughn will go to the bench and get a big hand from the Kansas faithful, and many of the Southern Californians who turned out today for this first Wooden Classic as the Friends misses the first free throw. Take a look at our Napa players of the game now. For Kansas, it is Jacques Vaughn, 14 points, and equaling his career high with 11 assists. And, of course, Lou Rowe, just one shy of his career high, 33 points and 10 rebounds. Napa will donate $1,000 to the General Scholarship Fund of each school in the name of these student-athletes. Napa, we keep America running. Off three, kicks high and through. Just 2 seconds left. Right with a steal as the horn sounds. So the UMass Minutemen thrash Arkansas to take over number one. And today it's the 7th-ranked Jayhawks of Kansas that knock off UMass by a final score of 81-75. Lou Rowe put on a show for the Minutemen, enhancing his credentials as National Player of the Year, but it was the overall hustling play, smart play of the Jayhawks that proved to be the deciding factor in the end. And right now, winning coach Roy Williams is with Paul Sunderland. Paul?
All right, thanks, Tom. We're going to have to start spelling California with a K. You recruit those kids, they come back in and play so well. Of course, I'm speaking of your backcourt, Jacques Vaughn and Jared Haff.
Well, they were really sensational, particularly the second half. At halftime, I didn't think they had played very well. They had like 7 or 8 turnovers, just the two of them. But the second half, I thought they were sensational on both ends of the court.
You were very concerned, as will anyone who plays Massachusetts, about their ability to go to the backboard. You said at halftime you had out-rebounded them. You didn't feel like it. Do you feel like you out-rebounded them now?
Well, we did a little bit better job. I feel like it was a lot better. You have to look at those stats, I guess, because they're not supposed to lie. But Scott Pollard, Ray Plafinch, and Greg Ostertag were much better in the second half also.
Your feelings on winning the first game in the inaugural John Wooden Classic?
Well, you know, it's one game, and we've got to understand that, but we're as happy as we can be just for this one game.
Are you number one now?
I could care less, and that's a promise.
He will care in March, indeed. That's a promise. Back to you, Tom.
All right, Paul, 81-75. The first game of the John R. Wooden Classic is in the books, and Kansas has defeated the number one team, 81-75. And, of course, that's the first of two games still to come. The third-ranked Wildcats of Kentucky and the fourth-ranked Bruins of UCLA. Now let's go to Hannah Storm in New York.
Thanks, Tom. The between games intermission is usually a chance to take a break for a few minutes, but not today. Dick Enberg has a two-part special on John Wooden, the coach, the teacher, the living legend. We'll have that right after these messages from your local station.
The Red Storm of St. John's and the Panthers of Pitt in the Big East debut of Felipe Lopez.
We'll have that for you right now as we head to Albany in the East. We'll be tracking these games.